Good day, everyone, and welcome to Zee Entertainment's 3Q earnings discussion. Hope you all are well and taking good care of yourselves. We have today with us our Managing Director and CEO, Mr. Punit Goenka, to discuss the performance of the company for the third quarter of fiscal 2021. Unfortunately, our CFO, Mr. Rohit Gupta, had a family emergency due to which he had to rush to Delhi. He would not be attending the call today. This is the reason we are unable to do this on a webcast as we have been doing for the last couple of quarters. We'll start with a brief statement from PG, and we'll subsequently open the floor for question and answers round. Before we begin, I would like to remind everyone that anything we say during this call that refers to our outlook for the future is a forward-looking statement and must be taken in conjunction with the risks that we face. We'll begin the opening remarks now. Over to you, PG.
Thank you, Bijal. Good evening, everyone. It is always a pleasure to connect and interact with you all. Since this is the first time that I'm speaking to you in the year 2021, let me begin by wishing each one of you a wonderful year ahead. With all that we have together experienced in the previous year, there is certainly a strong level of collective hope and positive energy across, and I'm most certain that this new year would be a great one for all of us. With the sharp and steady decline of the COVID-19 cases over the last couple of months, coupled with the easing restrictions, the process of all aspects returning to normalcy has certainly accelerated, both in terms of our day-to-day life and in terms of the overall economic activity. To add to this, the vaccination drive, which has already begun across the country, gives us the hope and confidence that we step into the next financial year, the chapter of pandemic will be behind us. Indian economy at large is quite resilient, which is evident from the robust growth reported by companies across sectors and the encouraging outlook shared by most of them. As all of you must have noted, this is despite an unprecedented first half decline experienced across the board. Even for us, the advertisement revenues have returned sharply to positive growth trajectory in the third quarter of this financial year. Our advertisers are seeing a strong revival in demand with the product launch cycle, which was stunted by the pandemic, witnessing a strong rebound. The blend of growth-oriented policies, multi-year low interest rates, and the country's ever-expanding consumer base will act as a strong catalyst for growth going forward. During the lockdown, content consumption witnessed a sharp spike, reinstating the fact that content is an indispensable part of our daily life. In India, content consumption has been in a secular growth phase across platforms, and the same is likely to continue. We firmly believe that the current digital consumption has only scratched the tip of the iceberg, and that there is an immense potential for the total addressable market to grow multifold. While television continues to be the biggest entertainment medium, the sheer fact that over 100 million households are yet to buy their first television sets speaks a lot about the potential and growth prospects of this industry. We would like to achieve a dominant share of capitalizing this growth opportunity, which is going to unfold over the next decade or so. As you all might have noted, while articulating the Zee 4.0 strategy approach, I had spoken about growth being one of the key pillars of the new journey. Over the past 6 months, we have been consistently working to devise a five-year growth map for the company. After a rigorous exercise and internal deliberations, we have set internal targets in terms of time and entertainment share that we as a company must garner in the next 5 years. To achieve these targets, there would certainly be substantial increase in our investments across digital, television, and movie production businesses. I would like to elaborate this point further by speaking about these three business verticals. Let us start with digital. For ZEE5, our ambition is to make a leading OTT platform, not just for India, but for South Asian diaspora across the globe. Much like our broadcasting business, we will be following a multilingual approach, ramping up the original content production across languages. As more and more viewers join us on the digital platforms, it would be imperative for us to raise our investments in order to cater to their unique tastes and preferences. The expansion in content offering will be supported by parallel investments in marketing and technology, to improvise the overall consumer experience. Moving on to our broadcast business, our aim is to consistently be India's number one entertainment network. As you all must have noted, we have already added 6 new channels to our network over the past 14 months. While the expansion approach for the linear business is almost complete, we might see a few launches in the coming years. The viewership of our network has seen some decline over the last 1 year, and to gain back the leadership, we plan to enhance our spends in the Hindi-speaking markets as well as few regional language markets. Movies business, on the other hand, has been an integral part of our growth story. We re-entered the movie production business few years ago with an objective to develop a profitable and scalable model. Like any content business, even we had our share of success and failure. But that said, on an aggregate basis, the performance has been satisfactory. We now plan to increase our annual movie releases to 35 to 40 across 6 languages from the current number of 8 to 10 releases a year. This would also have a flywheel effect for our digital, broadcast, and music business. To summarize the points, our investments in content would see a hike in the financial year 2022. This phase would be somewhat similar to what we experienced around a decade ago, wherein our investments in regional markets did temporarily impact our EBITDA margins, but at the same time, it also enabled us to grow ahead of the market for many years. The investment decisions will have an impact on our margins, working capital, and cash generation. Our business plan for the coming year will be finalized during quarter four, and we would provide a granular guidance on these line items during the fourth quarter investor dialogue. As Bijal mentioned that Rohit could not join us today, I will run you through the operating highlights as well. After the disruption faced due to the unprecedented economic slowdown in the first half, our business returned to near normalcy in third quarter, led by strong resurgence in consumer demand across categories. Advertising witnessed a sharp rebound as sale of products across all categories saw a strong recovery. With the lockdown easing across the country, people began to spend more time out of their homes, leading to normalization of TV viewership to pre-COVID levels. While movie genre had gained massively during the first half, the category suffered some fatigue due to lack of new content and saw a drop in viewership share, which benefited the GEC genre. During the quarter, we maintained an all-India viewership share of 18.2%, and continued to be India's number two TV entertainment network. Continuing with our strategy of diversifying our content offering to the consumers and going deeper into the regional markets, we launched 2 channels, Zee Zest and Zee Wajwa. While Zee Zest is a lifestyle channel, Zee Wajwa brings the best of Marathi music to our audiences. With this, we have introduced 6 new channels in the market over the last 14 months, significantly bolstering our offering to the consumers. All of our new channels have started on a strong footing and will continue to strengthen our network share going forward. During the quarter, Zee TV, Zee Bangla, and Zee Kerala improved their viewership share respectively, and the Hindi movie cluster maintained its number one position. However, we lost leadership in Marathi, one of our traditionally strong markets. We are working towards fixing the gaps which we have identified in our content offerings, and we hope to see the results of the same in the next couple of quarters. Now coming to Z5, the platform's global MAUs and DAUs for the month of December, as per our internal data analytics, were 65.9 million and 5.4 million respectively. During the quarter, Z5 released 20 original shows and movies. With close to 200 original shows released since launch, Z5 now has the biggest library of Indian original content, which will help in ramping up paid subscriber base as we go forward. Z5 also released 7 movies on our new pay-per-view platform, Zplex, which enabled consumers to watch some of the new movies from the comfort of their homes. The revenue and EBITDA losses of Z5 for the quarter was ₹1.2 billion and ₹1.8 billion respectively. Z Studios, our movie production and distribution arm, took the lead in the efforts to normalize movie-going habits. Our Hindi movie Suraj Pe Mangal Bhari and Telugu movie Solo were the first to hit the cinema theaters since lockdown in the respective markets. Zee Music Company added over 5 million subscribers during the quarter, and continues to be the second most subscribed Indian music channel on YouTube. The label witnessed a 50% growth in video views on a year-on-year basis. Now coming to the financial performance, before I get into the details, I'd like to call out two things that you would have seen in the financials. This quarter, we have struck a content syndication deal worth Rs. 5.5 billion, which has led to an extraordinary jump in the other sales and services revenue. Inventory worth Rs. 4.7 billion associated with this transaction has been charged to our profit and loss account, leading to a spike in our operating costs. Other aspect is that due to internal restructuring of business, a part of our music subscription income will now be reported as part of the international business from this quarter onwards, which will explain the jump in the subscription revenue. I will talk about the financial performance excluding the impact of these two. The revenue for the quarter grew by 6%, a sharp improvement from 19% decline that was seen in the last quarter. Like I had said earlier, advertising in domestic markets saw a strong rebound, which led to a 7.5% growth year on year. Domestic subscription revenue saw a like-to-like growth of 9.3% year on year, which is driven by both Z5 and the television network, and partially helped by a lower base. Like we had mentioned in the last quarter, due to the lingering uncertainty on NTO 2.0, our subscription growth this fiscal will be lesser than what we have delivered historically. Comparable programming costs for the quarter grew 11%, led by higher spends on Z5 and the new television channels. As Z5 video views grow, it will also lead to higher technology costs, which is part of our programming. Underlying EBITDA for the quarter stood at Rs. 6.4 billion and margin was 29.3%, an improvement of 635 basis points sequentially. The cash and treasury investments for the company were Rs. 18.2 billion as on 31st December 2020, which includes bank balance of Rs. 3.9 billion, fixed deposits of Rs. 6.5 billion, mutual fund investments of Rs. 7.3 billion, and entities worth Rs. 505 million. That is it from my end on the overall quarter performance front. Back to you, Vijay.
Yeah, hi, Janice. We can start Q&A.
Sure. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Abneesh from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, congrats Puneet and team on excellent numbers and higher disclosure levels. My first question is on the syndicate revenues jumping sharply. So could you tell us which geography, which client, why suddenly now, what was the thought process? And can we see more such deals in the coming quarters? Was this largely because of the better inventory you wanted to utilize? Was that the key reason?
Abhish, this was actually not specific to any one particular geography. It was spread across international markets. A large part of it was emerging from the fact the markets that we want to exit, case in point being Germany, some markets in the Spanish-speaking region that we want to exit in the future, and just a deal that fructified in this quarter. It was something that we've been pursuing from pre-COVID times, but it just happened in the last quarter. Hopefully, we would love to find such deals every quarter, but as you can imagine, they are far and few.
Right. Second question is on movie production, extremely risky business versus your core business. Now you want to scale up significantly, which you have mentioned earlier also. So my question is, do you want to be a big box office player, or the strategy will be to more supply good quality content to your own network? I'm asking this also because of the experience or learning from the last two movies, either on box office or on your own OTT, Suraj Te Mangalwari and the other one in terms of the Khali Pili. So, because in the past we have seen other movie production companies also struggle a lot. It's an extremely risky business. So, what kind of outlay and margins, if you could give us some sense on FY22 on this part of the business?
Yeah, so we will want to play the holistic film business game. Abneesh, as I talked about in our opening remarks, that we are targeting the time and the entertainment share of the consumer. And movies do form a significant part of the share for the consumers in our country. And therefore, we will play the holistic game of box office as well as it being a feeder of content into our own ecosystem of both or all three segments of digital broadcast as well as the music business. Obviously, it will be a low margin business compared to our traditional core business of television. But we do believe that the portfolio and the approach to towards selection of the films, we can make it sustainably profitable for us in the long term, and including in the fiscal 22 itself.
And anything on outlay and impact on the profitability, any sense on that?
So as I said, it will be a lower margin business compared to our television thing. I don't think specific guidance we are giving right now on that. But we will be giving you overall guidance, as I mentioned, by the end of quarter four on the overall business, which will factor in this low margin impact of the movie business.
Right. And last question on advertising. Normally, you give a feel of the outlook. Now we have seen economy rebound far higher than initial expectation. Still, some sectors are lagging. For example, travel, hospitality, etc., still lagging. So, if you could give us some sense on that part of the lagging sectors, and overall, how are you getting the feel? Is this more of a temporary shoot up in the economy, and that's why advertising, or you see FY22, irrespective of the base is extremely favorable. But when you see on a 2-year basis, do you see FY22 being an extremely strong year in terms of advertising?
So, Anish, also, you know, quarter three is the festive quarter, so that part also plays a role in the growth that you've seen. As I said, we are near normalcy. We are not back to the normal situation. So, quarter four should be better, and definitely in FY22, we will see growth for the industry overall. But whether it will be back to the normal, you know, 10%, 11% number or not, it's still very hard to say. We are yet to see this quarter before we can guide for the next financial year fully.
Yeah, that's very helpful, Puneet. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you, Anish.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sanjesh Jain from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you, and good afternoon. First, on the core business, on the television advertisement side, how has been the mix between volume and value? Are we in terms of pricing per 10 second in our core GEC portfolio back to pre-COVID level, or we still have a headroom in terms of growth, pricing-led growth in the advertisement?
Yeah, hi, Sanjay. So compared to 1Q and 2Q, we have seen significant improvement at both the places in pricing as well as inventory utilization. And it was a festive quarter, so, I mean, pricing was good. But that said, we continue to see possibility of improving pricing further. Typically, 80 to 85% of our growth in any particular year comes primarily from pricing because inventory are fixed. So, save for the impact of COVID, we typically run at 90 to 95% in all the key channels during prime time. So, largely our growth is always driven by pricing. And in the coming year, when Puneet is saying that the industry and us will most likely have a very strong growth, that will be largely driven by pricing again.
So, are we back to pre-COVID level, as in, are we back to last year pricing, or there is still a gap between the last year pricing to this year?
Depending upon channel to channel, but yeah, pretty much close to that, or in some of the channels it would be higher than that, some of the channels lower than that also. Viewership has a role to play in what exact price you get, but it is in that ballpark.
Got it. Second, on the Z5 portfolio, Now that we are one of the probably leading OTT player in terms of releasing original content, which Puneet rightly highlighted, we have released more than 200 originals. But in terms of subscriber addition or a movement from MAU to DAU, it still looks like we are lagging in terms of converting the monthly active users to daily active users. And in terms of revenue growth, again, considering that there is a revival in the advertisement, I think on the digital side, we also booked the advertisement revenue day. The quarter-on-quarter growth still doesn't look like that exciting in the Z5.
So I think one of the key things on Z5 that we lost base on was the fact that when we had no original content, because our MAUs are driven from the television content that we put onto the platform. So that had shrunk the funnel for us in a big way in the initial period of quarter one itself. And we've been building the base back from that period onwards. Obviously, it's far more stable now, as you saw the numbers of the last two quarters. And hopefully from this quarter onwards, the monetization will also start improving. On the subscriber side, we have had, again, standoffs with multiple operators, given the fact that a key property came only in the third quarter of this fiscal, and therefore we had to get off some platforms for commercial reasons. So that's a battle that continues to go on, Sanjay, and it's something that we'll continue to have to fight going forward as well.
Just one last question from my side, a follow-up on this. Can you give some color, how is the underlying growth in the paying subscriber customer in the portfolio?
Can you repeat your question?
So how has been the trend in the subscribers to pay, as in subscription-based subscribers?
So, yeah.
We don't share the number, but you can give a color feeler.
So it is pretty much in line with the revenue growth which you have seen during the quarter. So it is, the mix of revenue between ad and subscription POP hasn't changed much. And subscriber growth also has been in line with the revenue growth which we have seen during the quarter.
Okay, I was just asking because we had run a promotional offer, I think, in the PQ to add a subscriber at $6.99 a year. So I was just trying to understand, has it attracted a lot more customer? Because revenue may not have come, but customer may have grown faster.
So, Sanjay, there are continuously some scheme or the other scheme, and you would see that from us also, you would see that from others also. So, it is overall part of, annual plan which we build. So, nothing very different we have done. Of course, we have run a scheme, but there would have been something else in some other quarter.
Got it. Thank you, and best wishes.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Yogesh Kirve from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks a lot for the opportunity. So regarding the investment, the content investment phase we are talking of from FY22 onwards. So just a clarification. So will it be within the guidance on the free cash flow, the cash flow conversion that we used to talk about earlier, out of the 5% cash flow from operations to tax conversion? So that stays, or that could we also see some revision?
Good.
Yeah. So Yogesh, as Puneet pointed out, that we would be increasing our investment across three businesses, and as we increase our investments, there will be an impact on all the aspects, working capital as well as cash flow as well, and the margin. Still, we have not absolutely finalized the plan. There are certain things which is WIP right now, and that is the reason why we mentioned that during the fourth quarter, we'll give you granular guidance on all the three line items. So at this point of time, I will not be in position to guide you exactly. But guidance for FY22 will be available in 4Q FY21 call.
Okay, sure. So regarding second question, so if you look at the television subscription revenues, I understand there are a lot of sort of uncertainties at the moment. But from a medium-term perspective, what are our growth expectations and what are the key drivers of that? I understand the taking plain vanilla price hike might be a little more challenging than used to be in the past. So what could be the drivers? Is it like a HD convergence or any other factors that could drive it?
So if the regulation stabilizes and things become normal in a stable situation, a low teens to mid teens kind of expectation is fair, which is both on account of pricing as well as discovery of subscribers that may not be paying currently.
Okay, and it's just sort of a broad classification in terms of what could be the subscriber growth expectations built into that number that we just spoke about.
Yeah, see, as Puneet also mentioned during the opening remark, that there are 100 million homes are yet to get their television set itself. So we continue to see at least 2 to 4% increase depending upon year household, I mean television household population. So that is one growth driver. After that, some conversion to HD, some upselling, there are other drivers. We continue to add more channels to our portfolio. That also enables us to take price hike, which is not plain vanilla price hike, but that is a price hike on account of the fact that we are offering more content. So all this put together, low to mid-teens kind of revenue growth can be driven if the policy environment is stable.
Okay. Sure. And just finally, the data point. So there was sort of the sale of overseas mutual fund that was pending in the last quarter. So has that happened during the quarter?
Yeah, that has been received.
Okay. Sure. Thanks a lot and all the best.
Thank you, Yogesh.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Arun Prasad from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you. So my question is on more on from Z. So sorry, I got disconnected in between. If it is a repeat question, one is that your DAU
Mr. Prasad,
on the platform.
I'm so sorry to interrupt. Requesting you to please speak a bit louder, sir.
Yeah. So I hope now it is all right. Okay, so my question is on ZFI DAU. So daily active users has been more or less stable around 5 to 6 million for last many quarters. I just wanted to understand what would be your medium-term target in terms of this metric. What is your expectation from this platform? And to achieve the target, what are the strategies we have in place apart from increasing spends on the content?
The MAU to DAU conversion is still going to be focused largely from catch-up TV for us, Arun. So we are not really going to be investing capital behind MAU to DAU conversions. Our expectations on the investments will be largely on the original content and movie content that we will build for the subscription acquisition. Our conversion rate from MAU to DAU we would be targeting in the midterm around 15% to 18%, let's say by end of the next fiscal. That will be an industry benchmark that we should be looking at.
Okay. But even within that, if you see the average time spent, this is still lagging behind most of your peers with a similar content or the subscription rates. Is there any particular reason for this? For this, some kind of lagging behind the peers?
The fact, Arun, that because I said again, you know, it is catch up TV and some of the key shows may not be performing as well on television. So that same effect is seen on OTT as well. So as in when you have more hit shows on television, the catch up consumption also gets driven up. So it's a kind of a, you know, same situation that is impacting both the linear business and the long-term business.
All right. Thank you. I'll get back to you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Vora from BNP Paribas. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. On the new strategy, you mentioned that with that, there could be some pressure on margins. Would you also see an acceleration of revenue growth, and would that happen in FY22 or it will be back-ended? And is it fair to assume that the 30% margin you have earlier guided to will not come through, but will the sales be higher to offset the impact, and does the EBITDA growth should still be strong? I mean, I understand that you're going to like give more color next quarter, but anything which you can share here would be good.
No, certainly, we will not be able to deliver on the 30% EBITDA margin guideline, given the fact that, you know, the full-fledged growth level, even we can't predict right now for financial year 22. So, we have to wait and watch and only talk more granular in the next quarter. But I do expect some impact on margins to happen.
But would there be an impact on sales as well, or sales impact would be better?
So, Kunal, definitely as we are spending more money, there will be incremental sales. But many of the business like digital and also to an extent in television, we'll first have to make investment, and typically revenue follows in due course of time. So there will be definitely immediate impact on sales, which will be positive, but full impact of the investment which we are making would be visible over a period of time. So as Puneet mentioned during the opening remark, that in FY, around 10 years back, around FY12, we were making investment. In the near term, it actually impacted margin, but over next several years, it helped us grow much ahead of industry. So that's the broad thesis with which we are working. So initially, it will have an impact on margin, and later years, we will benefit on account of that.
Understood. Second one on the content syndication deal, has the cash already been collected, or is it reflecting in the balance sheet as I see that receivables have increased?
No, the cash has been received.
Okay, so in that case, the receivables has increased. Any reason for that, further increase in receivables?
Yeah, firstly, there is more sales in quarter three itself, so receivables would go up on that account. Secondly, there is a whole amount of incentive which needs to be paid out on account of distribution that is sitting in our liability but still reflecting in our receivables as well. So it's not apples to apples comparison from that perspective.
Understood. And lastly, like post the pandemic, have you seen any changes in content costs? As there could be demand supply mismatch as various broadcasters look to strengthen their content slate while production might not be fully back. Similarly, on movies, have the prices changed compared to pre-pandemic level?
So on the content cost for television, there has not been any change because on the cost per hour basis, things are pretty much stable because there is still ample supply available for content for television side. On the movie side, cost had gone up even pre-COVID levels with the advent of digital. But on the other side, for television, the content cost has come down on the film side. So it's kind of evening out itself. But collectively, still the costs are higher on the film side in the short term, especially in the Hindi market. The impact is not as extreme in the regional markets as you'd see in India.
Understood. Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Kunal.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one. The next question is from the line of Ankit Kedia.
Sir, just wanted to ask on the, you know, advertiser confidence on the back rating now, post what we have seen, in the press, while the court case is going on the back rating, what's your thoughts on that and how are the advertisers?
So I will answer this in my current position, not as the other position. I think the back ratings impact largely the news genre and not so much the genre that we operate in, which is entertainment. As you can see, the ratings for the entertainment channels have been coming out as usual, and there has been no change whatsoever to that. Therefore, I see no reason for any doubt in the mind of advertisers for the BART rating system for the entertainment channels. And the total impacted viewership that we're talking about is 7% of the viewership of this country, which is the entire news genre put together. Was that clear? Hello?
Hello?
Can take the next one. We can come back. Hello? What is that lady's name?
Janice,
can you hear?
Yes, sir. The next question is from the line of Prateek Rangnekar from Credit Suisse. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good evening. Thanks for the opportunity. One quick question from my side on advertising, sir. We've seen a very sharp pickup in the advertising run rate from minus 26 last quarter to 7.5 growth this quarter. Just wanted to understand, are there any particular sectors or segments that you're seeing growth in? And are there any particular segments which are yet to grow here? And what was the, if you could provide your estimate on what was the industry advertising growth this quarter?
Yeah, hi Prateek. So overall, we have seen growth across the sectors. And I mean, I'm not sure you are asking YOY or relative to previous quarter. As compared to previous quarters, there is growth across the sector. If I look at compared to last year also, there is growth across most of the sector. Auto has done pretty well as compared to what it was doing last year. And FMCG continues to drive the bulk of increase in expense in the industry. At industry level, growth was minus 2 is our estimate. And that is excluding impact of IPL. So I'm talking only about entertainment, where growth would have been close to minus 2% for the industry.
Thank you so much. So any particular sector where which you think on a YOY basis is yet to pick up? I mean, I understand you said FMCG and autos have done well. Is there any sector which is yet to pick up?
FMCG itself is a very, very large sector, and auto was also doing pretty well. And then we saw good growth in e-commerce also. Consumer durable was also doing pretty well. So the there might be few sectors which are which have not done so well YOY, but they are not really that large that which will change overall growth of the industry.
Okay, sir. Thank you. My next question is on the content inventory pie chart that you guys provide. So, on a quarter-on-quarter basis, we see that your shows and content advances have come down in absolute terms. So, is it that the syndication that was done has gone from shows and content advances?
Yeah, so as Puneet mentioned, that the content relates to a lot of international market where we shut down or we are thinking of shutting down. So though, there was inventory in those markets. So just as we talked about Germany, there was a lot of inventory which was kind of dubbed in German language, and that is of no use because we have shut the channel. So many such content pieces have gone out of shows, and so that's why you are seeing that decline. And advances is normal, so this advances work for content. So on delivery of content, that advances moves into inventory. So that normal transition from inventory, advances to inventory has happened during the quarter.
Okay, fine. So just one last question. Last quarter, you had mentioned content advances at around 400 crores. Is that number, can you provide that number this quarter? What is the number now?
No, so content advances is around 14% of 56.5 billion. And what you are referring to is the content deposit which we had paid and which were later on converted into advances, which were at around 4 billion, they are now around 3.6 billion rupees. Total content advances somewhere around, give me 1 second, I'll tell you, 7.6 billion.
Okay, fine. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Chikar Mistry from Buoyant Capital. Please go ahead.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for taking my question. It was a little bit of a clarification from my end. So,
if you look at that press note 8 on the accounts, the content monetization, would it be fair to assume that if I back calculate the cash from operation, save for that content advances, it would have been a negative cash flow from operation? And if at all, can you give some more color on who actually purchased this content and how one should look at it?
So, Vidar, I mean, mathematically that is correct. We received 5.5 billion on account of sale of this content, and that money has been received. During the quarter, we have seen a significant investment in working capital, which was one on account of the fact that revenues were going up. So we have seen working capital release in probably earlier quarter, and now we are seeing debtors going up. That is on account of the fact that there was a decline in revenue, and now there is an increase in revenues. So working capital release, which will happen during the first half, has got reversed. Secondly, there is also, I mean, first half, if you remember, I mean, there was hardly any content which was being produced, and content production itself had come to kind of standstill. So we have actually lost lot of, I mean, almost like 6 months. So we have actually ramped up content production also. So that is also one of the reasons why we have seen some increase in working capital. And overall, there is some negative free cash flow during the quarter on account of this reason.
Understood. Thank you. And any more color on, like, is this who actually helped monetize this content?
This is again an aggregator who does content across markets in the international thing that has taken the content from us.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rakesh Jhunjhunwala from Rare Enterprises. Please go ahead.
Yeah, congrats on a fine performance. My first question is that traditionally the IPL is held in the first quarter, and this time a large part of the IPL was in the third quarter. So how much has the advertising been affected because of the IPL being in the third quarter?
Sir, part of it would have impacted us, but it also helps us in a way because of the way IPL sells advertising, it is category exclusivity. So all the competitors or the people who buy IPL actually for share of voice go to competition. And so it also helps us in one way. And therefore, while it has had some impact, but also some help to us. Overall, from the industry point of view, IPL from quarter three would have taken away both on TV and digital put together about, 1400 crores of advertising.
And what was the total revenue of advertising, digital and TV?
For both, about 2000 crores.
No, total industry-wide revenue.
Industry-wide revenue for quarter three. Just give me a second, sir. About 8,000 plus crores, sir.
So that means about 15%, 14 to 15% of the revenue, which in every quarter wouldn't go to IPL when this time.
That's right.
And exchange rate affected, everybody's affected to the extent of 10 to 12%.
That's right.
Second question is, see, you have economic growth, which in the third quarter was at, say, a break-even level. Now, there are predictions of 15 to 16% nominal GDP growth next year. So how can the advertising not go up, you tell me? When the delta is so high in the economic growth, from nearly nil to 15%, and after advertising is a product of the total growth in the economy. So I don't understand that. How can there not be a substantial increase in advertising revenue next year if the GDP grows by 15%? I mean, if the GDP grows by 15%, revenue in advertising should grow by at least 20-25%.
You're right. It should grow by that amount, but you see, that will be the advertising growth for the entire industry overall.
Yeah, so you are part of that industry. You may gain some market share, you may lose some market share. But if the industry grows at 20%, I mean, there should be substantial, and your marginal costs are very few. So it will reflect in higher rates. So, I mean, in my personal opinion, your profitability should show far the greater growth, and I don't understand your hesitation in saying that.
Sir, give me a minute to try and explain to you. See, there are certain parts of the industry which we don't play in. For example, the digital side, which is not related to video, which is a large part of the industry today, which is, search and display advertising. So we have no role to play in that part, and that part also grows significantly higher.
No, no, but Puneet, I understand that, but how much percentage of search and, the other part in which you are not there is a total cake in the revenue? It may be 10% of the total advertising revenue. So you may grow at, if the industry grows at 20, you may grow at 15, because you don't participate there. I mean, I don't understand if the economy is to grow at 15-16% nominal, then how advertising growth can be less than 20%?
Sure.
And you're not in those segments today, no? So your segments will also grow 20%. You're not there in those segments even today.
I pray, sir, that your Bhavishyavani comes true, sir.
No, my Bhavishyavani is based on certain facts. I mean, if the growth tapers off, I could be wrong. I don't think if the growth comes at 15-16% nominal, advertising growth in your segments can be less than 18-20%. And as companies prosper more and compete more, they tend to advertise more.
Sure, sir. And also, we are coming from a lower base, so yes, the number should be higher.
Right, and your marginal profitability should be very high, because your content cost doesn't go up with your advertising revenues.
That depends. It will go up because of the other sectors. Television profitability, absolutely, you're right, will go up. Because the cost will not go up in that same proportion. But the investments in other pockets of our business will impact profit.
And you may invest, but today advertising is a bulk of your revenue, no?
Correct.
So advertising should be 75-80% of your revenue.
No, sir, it's about 65%. Sir.
Yeah, 60 is two-thirds, boss.
Yeah.
So the one-third may not gain, but two-thirds you will gain, no? And there the marginal profitability is very high. I mean, to my mind, I can be totally wrong, but with this kind of delta in the economic growth, all people whose businesses are high fixed cost based should become very, very profitable, yeah?
Sure, sir. Sure.
So I thought it would be better if you... I mean, I don't know. Let's see. Time will bear us out.
Sure, sir. We'll see how it plays out.
Yeah. Okay.
But I can assure you, sir, if industry grows at whatever clip, we'll beat that clip.
So I like that attitude.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And once again, congrats on a good performance. And you are going to make some change in your board of directors. So when can we expect that to be done?
We already brought two new directors onto our board that we announced last quarter itself.
Are you contemplating any further changes?
Not till we have any retirements coming up, sir.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vikrant Kashyap from Kedia Securities. Please go ahead. Mr. Vikrant Kashyap from Kedia Securities, you may please go ahead with your question.
Good afternoon, sir, and congrats on a good set of numbers. I have just one question. Can you please share update on our investment in Sugarbox?
Yeah, hi. So far, as far as our investments are concerned, we were talking about that we'll discuss with Railway because of COVID, there has been an impact. So, post our discussion, what we feel is that we will start our CAPEX primarily in 1Q of FY22, and entire rollout of the project will happen over the next 3 years. And you will start seeing the CAPEX for the project from the next fiscal.
Okay, so when we are continuing with the CAPEX from next year onward, Sugarbox will start generating revenue for our company, and what's our outlook for Sugarbox for next 5 years?
So Sugarbox already generates very minuscule right now. And the outlook for Sugarbox as per the projection is that within 2 years of operation, it turns cash flow positive for us.
Okay, so thank you and best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Naval from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. I have two, three questions. First is on CAPEX and margin guidance. Puneet, if you can share that for FY22, because we are now heading for a normalized scenario, you know, as ad growth has bounced back and would be improving in the ensuing quarters.
So CAPEX, Bijal, you want to just take?
Yeah, so CAPEX for the coming year, you are talking about?
Yes, 22.
Yeah, so there is nothing very special in the next year. There might be some increase in CAPEX on the development of G5 is there, but nothing really very large as compared to our regular CAPEX of 2 to 2.5 billion rupees in a normal year.
I missed out on that. G5's development of?
Yeah, so I mean, we are spending some money on two things. One is improving consumer experience, and another is ad tech. So on this, there might be some incremental capex in the coming year, but nothing very very large to change overall outlook for the capex. Typically, we, in a normal year, we end up spending 2 to 2.5 billion rupees. Should be in that vicinity.
And on margin guidance?
Margin guidance, Naval, it's still early for us to give that guidance. As Bijal talked about, and I also said in the opening remarks, that we are in the midst of our finalization of our plans for financial year 22. But it will certainly not be as per the guidance we have given of 30% in the past. But we'll come back to you with more granular details by the end of the year.
Okay. And on the other operating income, as we had large syndication revenues, so can you provide some details, you know, how much of content was sold, bought, from where? I mean, some details on that, because that number seems to be quite large.
So it is around, the number is given in the earnings release, it is around 4.7 billion rupees of content, that is the book value of the content, and that is mix of some content being bought, but large part of that being developed internally developed by us, and that content being sold to our content aggregator. So it is not something which we bought and we traded in. It has been there in our balance sheet for a while, and as we thought that this content may not be so much useful to us given our changed priorities in international market, we decided to put it on blocks, and we found a buyer and we sold it.
Understood. And how would have cash flow change adjusting for this? Because if I am correct that your receivable increase would also have a bigger chunk rising from this sale as well on sequential basis, if I look at it.
No, as we mentioned, that entire money with respect to the sale of 5.5 billion has been received. So there is no increase in debtors on account of that. Debtors increase, as I explained to one of the earlier participants, is on account of the fact that, see, we have seen capital release, working capital release in one half, when we have seen almost in first quarter 60% kind of decline in ad revenue. In the second quarter, there was another 25% plus decline in ad revenue. So that is the time working capital got released. Now, as our revenues are coming back to the normalcy, the working capital increase. Now, and also on the subscription side, if you see, typically what happens is that through the year we see subscription receivables going up, and towards the end of the year we see subscription receivables going down, because there are some of the negotiations which are going on, and till the time negotiations are not fully over, many times there are delay in payments. So that is normal cycle. You would have even in past seen that our receivable on account of subscription goes up during 2Q and 3Q and normalizes in 4Q. So that is the reason why we have seen an increase in working capital.
Understood. And apologies for being repetitive. I missed out on the initial remarks. I joined call late. And wish you all the best for the quarters.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Alankar Garude from Macquarie. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity and congrats on a good performance. My first question is on the advertising revenues. So broadly, Puneet and Bijal, in your conversations with advertisers, how are they thinking about 2021? Because what we hear in the market is that after the festival season this time around, in December especially, there was a significant increase in the advertising activity. So are you seeing that momentum continue? And secondly, because now IPL will come back again in the next few months, does that really change how advertisers are looking on the about advertising on the entertainment side?
No, I think the buoyancy on advertising still remains intact. Of course, the natural lag of quarter four will play out because quarter three being festive season will see the maximum peak. But year on year, there should still be growth in the fourth quarter of the current fiscal. And how IPL will impact, as I said again, the IPL is part of our life. It's nothing that impacts. The industry has also factored that in, that this event is going to happen every year. And therefore, there should not be any, people will be planning around that for their advertising spends from that perspective. So I don't see that having an impact on the industry overall. So that 2,000 crores that has to be spent on IPL will get spent on IPL, and the rest of the industry will get whatever else is to be spent on.
Understood. And secondly, Puneet, I'm sorry if you already answered this question. Can you comment on the outlook for subscription revenues, especially because we haven't seen any progress on the tariff order front?
So without the clarity on the tariff order front, it's very difficult to give any outlook. Right now, it is going to be, status quo. And until that regulatory issue doesn't get resolved, we are unable to take any price hikes or anything. So it's pretty much going to be status quo until that's resolved. Once that is resolved and stability resumes, let's say in a quarter or two post it being getting resolved, as I mentioned that early teens to mid-teens kind of growth can be expected from the subscription side.
Understood. Great. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the last two questions now. The next question is from the line of Rohit Prakash from Marshmallow Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. My first question is on Z5. In my research, I noticed that there has been quite a sort of attrition at in Z5 at various levels. Is that affecting the performance in terms of conversions and number additions as well?
So firstly, the attrition is planned attrition. So yes, it would be impacting some amount of operations on a day-to-day, but that's very short term.
The team entirely stabilized right now?
Yes, now the team that is in place is completely stabilized.
Great, so that's great to know. So the second question is on the board composition. So it was very interesting to see the profile of the board members that the company has added over the last one and a half years. But one profile that I, at least from my view, I find lacking is that given the move towards tech in general in media, we do not have anybody who's, it doesn't seem like we have anybody who's globally or nationally renowned for his or her tech expertise. So, given Z5 is a major part and Sugarbox is a major part of our growth strategy, should we not look at plugging that gap?
Yeah, Rohit, I think we should look at Mr. Veer Chandani's profile. He's been investing in tech companies for the last 15 years and runs a fund out of Mumbai. It may not be a very large fund on the lines of Sequoia or SoftBank or anything, but as an individual, his capabilities and understanding of the tech world is far more than anybody else. And that's the reason he was brought on board. And we can share his profile with you, not a problem.
Thank you. That's it for me. Thanks for answering my questions.
Thank you. We take the last question from the line of Mayur Gathani from OHM Group. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity. A couple of questions. There were some overseas funds that were due to come in this quarter. Have they come in? Or?
Yes, they have been duly received.
So all the funds that are around 225 CR has been duly received?
That's correct.
And how the receivable positions from the group companies, Dish and Citi, is Citi still paying you because you've taken a write-off in quarter two? So where do we stand on that?
Yeah, so as you are aware that in last quarter, we actually moved Dish, Citi Cable to cash and carry model. And the cash and carry model continues, so they pay for the content which they buy. And accordingly, there is no outstanding at this point of time as far as Citi is concerned, which is not provided for. As far as Dish TV is concerned, Dish TV continues to make payment as per the payment plan which was submitted. And as per that, I mean, Dish TV, Citi Cable receivable has come down. So it was around 5 billion rupees last quarter, which has come down to 4.6 billion rupees at the end of this quarter.
So when will we have the Dish TV receivables coming down to normal on a cash and carry basis or just?
Sorry. Dish TV I'm talking about. So Dish TV has been paying as per plan, and Dish TV's receivable came down from 5 billion to 4.6 billion during this quarter. As far as Citi Cable is concerned, there is no outstanding which is not provided. So Citi continues to pay on cash and carry basis.
And Dish TV return back to normal situation by September of this year.
So by September, you were expecting them to pay the 460 CR? That's the balance outstanding, previous outstanding?
Period of 3 to 4 months, that will remain, which is normally the credit period allowed for any...
Right. So majority of that will come back, so?
That's correct. Right. That's correct.
Right. Okay. Great, sir. Thank you and all the very best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Bijal Shah for closing comments.
Thank you, everyone, for your interest. Should you have any further queries, please feel free to reach out to Investor Relations.